Whilst many modern horror films are considered complex, scary movies are classically not always analysed in the same way that other cinema is. Of course, in reality, this is really dumb, as horror has always had a way of sneaking in smart subtext amid all the gore and sex that critics used to deem offensive. Yes, most 80s body horror and slashers were secretly about AIDS, and most late 70s American horror movies are somehow a metaphor for Vietnam. But going over all those again seems redundant. With some horror movies, you have to peel back the grimy, gross, and disconcertingly wet surface layers to find messages that you never thought to look for. So let's go digging, shall we? I am the surprisingly deep Ash from What Culture, and these are 8 horror movies with surprising deeper meanings. 8. Resident Evil is filled with Alice in Wonderland symbolism. Resident Evil is a fun, turn-off-your-brain horror movie. It is primarily remembered for Mila Jovovich ninja-kicking zombies and looking stellar whilst doing it. But there is more underneath this simple video game franchise brought to the big screen. Director Paul W.S. Anderson told Fangoria magazine way back when we all unironically liked Sum 41, and I quote, "It struck me that the fundamental idea of girl in a dress goes into a hole in the ground is exactly what both Alice in Wonderland and Resident Evil is." This connection to Alice in Wonderland is found all throughout Resident Evil. For example, the T-virus being tested on White Rabbit, the Umbrella Corporation's commandos constantly worrying about time, and the Alices of both stories going through a looking glass. Though, I will have to concede that the looking glass in Alice in Wonderland does not have death lasers like the one in Resident Evil. Perhaps it would have been more exciting if it did. There's also the aptly named AI baddie, the Red Queen. Like her Alice in Wonderland counterpart, the Red Queen causes many decapitations and even demands our protagonist does some decapitating of her own as her friend is turning into a zombie. Off with their heads! 7. The Stuff is about mindless consumption. The Stuff is another movie in a long line of 80s horror films that made no money and was rediscovered by hungry horror fans long after its debut. Surprisingly, its scathing commentary on advertising and health is more relevant today than it was in 1985. The Stuff is about the titular food product that has found its way into every refrigerator in America thanks to an extensive marketing campaign, and the stuff's strange addictiveness. Unfortunately, the stuff is alive, and after you consume enough of it, you turn into a zombie, and eventually white goo explodes from your face as you melt. It is up to a little kid and a former FBI agent to stop the stuff, because, well, the 80s. If by the third act there was any question as to what this movie was actually about, director Larry Cohen answers it when a Shack-style restaurant dedicated to selling the stuff, conveniently located between two popular fast food establishments, explodes. The stuff is a stand-in for any product that has been marketed to the general public regardless of health concerns, from sugary cereals to cigarettes. The symbolism isn't exactly subtle, but it is clever, unfortunately timeless, and gory good fun. Is anyone else craving a burger? 6. Texas Chainsaw Massacre wants you to be a vegetarian. For a movie with chainsaw and massacre in the title, the blood in the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre is kept to a minimum. However, you can see the characters sweating. You can feel the Texas summer heat. The sun-scorched tone leaves you wanting to take a shower more than a privileged college student after Coachella. The film, despite the lack of gore, is brutal, unforgiving, and strangely has a very pro-vegetarian message. After the gang pulls the mystery machine over to pick up a hitchhiker, he spends the better part of the first act explaining a couple different ways cows can be slaughtered. He tells them how smashing cows in the head with a hammer-like device was a better way to kill them, as opposed to using a gun that uses air pressure because that gun puts people out of jobs. The psycho family the hitchhiker belongs to proceeds to murder the gang in the same way the cattle are killed. The gang are systematically slaughtered for good eating. The Texas Chainsaw Massacre wants you to know how the sausage is made. It forces the audience to question the morality of meat production as they see people being treated like cattle. As a result, the film's director, Toby Hooper, said he couldn't eat meat whilst making the movie. 5. Slumber Party Massacre 2 is about repressed sexuality. Slumber Party Massacre 2 is a sequel to a sleazy 80s slasher. Therefore, by the rules of 80s sequels, it has to be sleazier and slashier than the first movie. The movie's about a teen girl named Courtney, and as a child, Courtney survived the events of the first film, but she soon discovers she is summoning the Driller Killer back from the grave with her dreams. The movie does not make a lot of sense unless you stop focusing on the surface of the plot and look at the film from the perspective of a teenage girl coping with sexual anxiety. Courtney has serious anxiety about sex after learning all her friends are are way more experienced than she is. This anxiety manifests itself into nightmares about a rockabilly version of the driller killer from the first movie. When Courtney goes to have sex, the worst thing that could happen to a teenage girl about to have sex for the first time does happen. Her sexual anxiety manifests into a killer. Who hasn't been there? Am I right, ladies? In Slumber Party Massacre 2, the killer is not a human that can be conquered. It is instead the creation of Courtney, an actual manifestation of what she perceives as forbidden sexual desires. Instead of making a direct sequel, writer-director Deborah Brock takes a theme from the first film, female sexuality, and hyper-focuses on it. This creates a horror movie villain out of one of the scariest or most anxiety-inducing things that people have to confront in their lifetime, which is having sex for the first time. 4. Candyman is about the struggle not to be forgotten. On the surface, Candyman is just a big screen adaptation of the popular folk story Bloody Mary. Dig just a little deeper and you can see how the movie tries to take on issues involving race and sexism. However, if you keep tunneling your way into the plot, you realize the movie is actually about a dead man who simply does not want to be forgotten. The film gives us the origin story of Candyman. He was a black painter in the 1890s America, just 25 years removed from the American Civil War. After falling in love with a white woman, a lynch mob attacked him and cut off his hand, the hand he used to create things he would be remembered for. They then cover him in honey, attracting bees that sting him to death. It is gruesome, but gives birth to Candyman. His paintbrush is now replaced with a bloody hook, and painting is replaced with his newfound notoriety as an urban legend. We can see how seriously he takes his new art form when a gang leader who has taken on the moniker of the Candyman is arrested and gets charged with the murders committed by the real Candyman. Candyman is enraged by this imposter taking credit for his art and warns that he now must shed innocent blood. Fear is his new art form, an art form he will use to be remembered even after death. When he was alive, he painted to remain relevant, and in death, he kills so he does not disappear into irrelevancy. Like all of us, he simply wants to leave a legacy and doesn't want to be forgotten. 3. Silent Hill is about the horrors women face. 2006's Silent Hill was supposed to be entirely female-driven. There is a subplot with Sean Bean that feels disconnected from the rest of the movie, though. And the only reason the out-of-place subplot exists is because screenwriter Roger Avery only added in his character after getting the screenplay notes back from the studio complaining about the lack of men in the movie. The lack of men, though, is the entire point. The film takes all the monsters from the video game it is based on, which were manifestations of a male protagonist's sexual frustrations as his wife was dying, and gender swaps the perspective. In the game, the nurses represent the male protagonist's guilt for sexualizing the medical professionals caring for his terminally ill wife. These monsters are faceless and zombie-like, their only notable human features being their slender female figures and large breasts. When this is viewed from a female perspective, the nurses become a representation for the horrific ways men sexualize women, ignoring their faces and personality. The movie goes all in on female horror, with the children made from ash representing the fear and pressure of motherhood, and Pyramid Head symbolizing male sexual brutality. Director Christopher Gans even goes as far to describe the scene with Pyramid Head stabbing at an elevator our heroines are hiding in as a rape scene. If you still need convincing that Silent Hill is about the horrors that women face, one of the first monsters our heroines see upon entering Silent Hill is an ominous phallus with legs that spits at them. 2. The Descent is a tragedy about mental illness. A short plot description of The Descent sounds like your typical horror movie fodder. A girl named Sarah loses her husband and daughter in a car accident, and in order to help her cope, her friends conceive the worst plan ever: to take Sarah caving on the anniversary of said terrible tragedy. In the cave, monsters called crawlers begin murdering all of her friends. However, much like the caving expedition, The Descent has much more going on than what is on the surface. There's a popular fan theory that Sarah is the killer in The Descent and there are no monsters. Sarah is on some heavy antipsychotics, and she doesn't bring her medication with her on the caving expedition. She's often framed and blocked the same way as the monsters, and there's even a scene where she screams and it is warped into that of a crawler. The cave is Sarah's mind, and the crawlers are her anger and grief. If you stop taking your medication, you will most likely not murder all your friends at the first sign of trouble. But you can lose parts of yourself when a mental illness takes over. In this way, Sarah murdering her friends represents her killing parts of herself. Or it could even be symbolic of Sarah's deteriorating mental health killing her real-life relationships. The movie's title, The Descent, is not simply about a descent into a scary cave, but a woman's descent into mental illness. If you like this theory in particular, then I go into more detail on it on our channel, That Film Theory, which you can catch in the description. But as for our last entry, 1. Demon Knight broke racial barriers. Tales from the Crypt is a television series that aired on HBO in the late 80s and early 90s. That paved the way for HBO to become the network known for supernatural creatures having sex and uncensored violence, a torch that continued to be carried next by True Blood and then by Game of Thrones. In 1995, the world decided that Tales from the Crypt's nudity and violence could not be confined to the small screen, and Demon Knight was made. The most anyone takes away from Tales from the Crypt Demon Knight is usually just a cheesy good time. However, the movie is actually exemplary of the way race should be represented in horror films. The film is helmed by a black director, a rarity in 90s Hollywood. Demon Knight also features one of the precious few black final girls in Jada Pinkett Smith, and no one in the film feels need to constantly point out that she is black. She just so happens to be a black character in a horror movie, with none of the tropes or stereotypes that that usually entails. Demon Knight was already an obscenely underrated horror movie featuring a great cast, including William Sadler taking his role way too seriously, Billy Zane at his Billy Zaniest, and Pinkett Smith knocking it out of the damn park. Considering its historical context, it may just be one of the best horror movies of the last 30 years. And that's our list. What other horror movies are like ogres and full of layers? Share your thoughts in the comment section below. I've been Ash, and this has been What Culture. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and come back again soon for some more spine-tingling horror content. Thanks for watching.